talk and rock radio, where friends meet at the intersection of life, inspiration, and music. Here's your host, Rick Kern.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Chambers Brothers.
Welcome, everyone, to Talkin' Rock Radio. My special guest today is a musical artist that penned the phrase, "My soul was psychedelicized." From Los Angeles, California, welcome Willie Chambers of the Chambers Brothers. How you doing, brother?
Hey, everybody. Doing great, man. Doing great. How about yourself?
Doing great, man. It's so good to have you with us today. Thank you for agreeing to join in with the show today. We're going to have a little bit of fun.
My pleasure. My pleasure.
Originally from Carthage, Mississippi, Father George Chambers, Father George Chambers and Mother Victoria and 13 kids honed their skills as members of the choir and their Baptist church there. And that's kind of where it all began musically, right?
Correct. It started in the cotton fields back in Mississippi.
Yeah.
Actually, and around the fireplace after working all day, there was always singing and storytelling. The first singing I ever heard came from my family.
Fantastic. And of course, they were religious, you know, gospel type songs. I mean, from the church.
Religious. Yes. Yeah. Yes.
That's fantastic, man. I know as you were doing your thing out there, working hard and singing in the church and living in, you know, the life of a large family. Your brother George, he ended up going into the Korean War, what, in 1952?
Yeah, we were working in the fields one day, and like my two younger brothers, Joe and Lester, we and two of our cousins, we had a little junior gospel group. And my brother George and another older brother, Major, they were in a senior group. But we sang separately when we went out to perform. But in the fields, we sang together. And one day we were just singing along, and we decided, why don't we just have a group among ourselves? But we couldn't come up with a name, so that's how we ended up being the Chambers Brothers. everybody introduced titles, name for the group, but we couldn't get everybody liking one particular name that everybody came up with. So, well, we'll just have to be the Chambers Brothers.
There you go. Well, you probably saved a lot of arguments by doing it that way.
Yeah, and at that same moment, George got drafted into the Korean War. So we waited for him to return.
Which was in 54, right?
Yes, sir.
Now, when he came back, he had already made his decision that he wanted to head out to L.A., so you guys had to hang out a little bit longer, right? And then you went out and joined him.
3 years later, we all joined each other in Los Angeles, California.
Yeah. Now, that period of time, the four brothers, you know, got together out in Southern California and formed your group again and started doing some folk music. I know there's a famous club out there called the Ash Grove in LA.
That's how gospel music got introduced to clubs and nightclubs and places that sold and consumed alcoholic beverages. Lightning Hopkins was in town, and I was playing guitar for a blues singer by the name of Luke Long Gone Miles. And that was Bumps Blackwell introduced me to him. Bumps Blackwell was a well-known producer, record producer out here. And he called me one evening and asked me, would I be interested in playing guitar for a blues singer? And I said, sure. So I went and met this guy, and we became a team. And my brother Joe was doing hair in the kitchen, and he had did this guy's hair, and Lightning and him were friends. They were both from the same place, someplace in Texas. And Lightning saw Long Gone's hair, and he says, hey, I want that. I want my hair like that. So a fella drove Lightning down here to pick my brother up to go to the beauty supply store to get the chemicals that they might need to relax that kinky hair. And the driver happened to be Ed Pearl, who ran and owned the Ash Grove. And okay. Lightning and my brother was talking, and my brother was saying, me and my brothers have a group, and the guy driving wanted to know, well, what kind of group do you have? And my brother says, we have a gospel group. And he says, gospel group? What's that? That's music that we sing at church and religious settings. So he says, why don't you guys come down to my club and audition? Maybe you can get hired. So we went and auditioned. Well, the people had never experienced that high energy, hand clapping, foot stomping gospel music. And it went over like people really enjoyed that. Man, there weren't a person sitting in their seat. And everybody was jumping up and running around and screaming and hollering and knocking tables over and knocking the drinks to the floor. Well, after the audition, Mr. Pearl says, I can't hire you guys. I can't sell drinks when you're on stage. Look at my place. It's a mess because everybody knocked the drinks off the table. And so I said to him, I said, well, don't they buy another drink afterwards? And he says, yeah. So he suggested we come back in a week or so and audition again. And we went and we did that, and he took us on for 3 weeks. And that's where we met a white lady blues singer by the name of Barbara Dane. And we did the 3 weeks there, and Lightning Hopkins, or Ramblin' Jack Elliott, that was on the bill. And at the end of the three weeks there, Barbara Dane said to us, I have a East Coast tour coming up. I would like to take you guys with me. If I took you guys with me, would you go? We said, sure, yes. We was excited because we'd never been in a place but Mississippi and here. And we were excited about that. But then we realized after thinking about it, wait a minute, we don't have any money. How can we go to the East Coast? Well, we said to her, we would like to go, but we can't afford to go. She said, don't worry about it. I'm gonna take care of you. I'm gonna put you in a hotel. I'm gonna feed you. I'm gonna take care of you. And she says, I think if the people get a chance to see you guys, you're gonna make it. And I want to help if I can. Please, would you go? We said, sure. So that's exactly what she did. But anyway, doing gospel in the at the Ash Grove, man, it took over. So it got so, it, I mean, it just took off. It just went. Sky was the limit. And it really got attention to the music industry. The Los Angeles Times came and interviewed us there. And Mahalia Jackson got wind of it. And she refused to sing in a gospel. She refused to sing gospel in a club or any place. It had to be a religious setting for her. And I think she felt like she was losing out. And she went to, there was a talk show, one of the early talk shows, Paul Coates talk show. She went there and she did a whole thing. And then she went to the Los Angeles Times and she did a whole spread. I got it on my wall in the bathroom right now. And she slammed that. She said it was blasphemia and it should not be. And we were terrible people and we should be ashamed of ourselves. And when the club owners heard about that, it scared the living daylights out of them, that they knew blaspheming means something pertaining to religious, and we couldn't get a job anymore. Man, we were eating peanuts and drinking soda, those big party pack bottles. It was a 25-cent deposit on those bottles, and we would drink those sodas all week long and eat peanuts, roasted peanuts. And we had a belly full of roasted peanuts and soda all week long. And there was a 25-cent deposit on the bottles. At the end of the week, we would collect enough bottles that we'd go get the money from the recycle. And there was a Johnny's pastrami right down below our band house. And we would go down there and get two big pastrami. You know how much meat they put on a pastrami sandwich? It's like tons of meat.
Yeah.
We would go get two of those. And we had this tray. We would slice them up, and we would have a feast every weekend. And gospel music had never been presented in that kind of setting before, but it really got great and big. New York, Chicago, London, all over the globe, man. It just took off.
I got to tell you, Willie, it's still big. When I went to bed last night, I was listening to it when I went to bed. I was listening to the Gaither vocal band. You know Bill Gaither, I'm sure.
Uh-huh.
You know? And they're one of my most favorite gospel groups. I mean, they're so darn good. Their harmonies are great. But Bill Gaither, I mean, and the Stamps Quartet, Elvis Presley, when you think about these guys, I mean, Elvis Presley, that was his foundation for his music, it came from the gospel church.
That's right.
You know?
That's right. Absolutely.
And the Stamps Quartet, I mean, one of the guys that I recently interviewed, Royce Taylor, he sings with the Vogues, and he was with the Elvis's Imperials and the Stamps and all that. And we talk a lot about gospel music, man, and it's roots music. It's really
it's beautiful,
so good,
man. It has an energy that that's a lot of other musics don't have. With Ms. Mahalia Jackson being considered the queen of gospel, everybody took her comments on a serious consideration, because she was considered to be the queen of gospel music.
She was my mom's favorite singer, man. I mean, she and Tennessee Ernie Ford, those two singers,
Tennessee Ernie Ford
and Mahalia Jackson were some of the very best. I mean, really.
Mm-hmm. Yes, sir.
Well, you know, when you guys, around 1965, Barbara took you guys out to New York, and you added Brian Keenan. Yeah.
Yeah, we were when Bob Dylan, we were good friends with Bob Dylan before he was ever on stage. He used to come to our band house and hang out with us. And he was just getting into it at that time. And when he was recording Highway 66, I think Revisited, he wanted us to do some background vocals on some of his cuts. And we were hanging out with him in the studio in New York. And he would say, after the session tonight, we're going to go to a discotheque. We'd never heard that phrase. What's that? Well, no. they have a live band and they play disc. Okay. So after the session, we went over to a place called Undine's, and that's where we met Brian Keenan. And we walk in there, and like, man, the place was jam-packed with people. and everybody's having a great time. And there was a local band performing. And then when that band finished, they played records. And we were sitting there, and they had food also, some of the greatest steak dinners you ever want to see. So we all had a big steak dinner. We were sitting there eating. And some guy comes out on stage and says, "Hey, we got a guest group in the house tonight from California, all the way from California. We're going to have them up in a minute." We had no idea they was talking about us, because we were doing the folk thing at that time. We didn't even have a drama at that time. And we were just doing the folk scene. And later on, they came out and said, "Now, ladies and gentlemen, the guests we promised you, they're here, and they're going to come up and do a few numbers, the Chambers Brothers." I said, "Oh, my God. What are we supposed to do? This is a discotheque. Everybody's dancing. So what are we going to do?" So we were kicking it among ourselves. Well, I said, "Why don't we just ask that drummer? We'll do the same songs we do. We'll just speed them up to a dance tempo, and we'll see if that drummer will sit in with us and play the drums." So we approached him and asked him if he would sit in, and he said, "Sure." Man, we got on that stage, and we, four bars into the first song, we looked at each other and said, "Man, this is the fifth brother right here.
All right.
This guy, he just blended in right in." And so at the end of the night, we were getting ready to sign with Columbia Records at the time. So we approached him and asked him if he would be interested in being our drummer, our permanent drummer, our fifth brother. And he says, "Yeah." Well, so we explained to him that we had an appointment to sign with Columbia Records. And after that signing, we would give him a call, and we would send him a ticket to come to California. We have a two-story band house, and you have your own living, your room and everything, you know, this. And we have a basement, and in the basement, we have a rehearsal studio we put together. And you just come and live in the house. We'll all live in the same house, and we'll just be there to play music. And when that time came, sure enough, we sent for Brian, and he came. Him and his wife came, and they lived right in the house. And it was a reunion that was to die for, to live for, maybe.
Yeah, really.
Yeah, he was one of the best drummers around, but he didn't get the recognition from the drum magazines and all of that, because we were an integrated group. And back in those days, that was taboo. You just didn't do anything. No, you just didn't do stuff like that. And like, we were always kind of like oddballs. We were never, the record labels was never able to categorize us, because we did a wide variety of music, and in our sets, we covered the whole thing. And like, it was hard to say we weren't pop, we weren't R&B, we weren't rock and roll, we weren't all the way gospel. But gospel was our main, that's what we loved, and that's what we always sang, and that's what we wanted to sing to the day we die. But when Mahalia Jackson said it was terrible, and we couldn't get any work, so we had rent to pay. We couldn't pay our rent. The landlord is coming around, so, "Hey, you're 3 months, what are you going to pay the rent?" You know, stuff like that. So like, the club owner started to call us and say, "Wait, we want you guys in the club, because we drew a crowd. People would come to see our show because of the energy level that we presented. And we couldn't get any work. And the club owners were saying, we can't hire you anymore as a straight out gospel group, because then the union stepped in and said that every member of the group had to be paid union scale or above and stuff like that. And that really put a kink in our rank. So yeah, well, the club owners was asking us, "Can you guys mix it up? Can you do blues? Can you do jazz? Can you do rock and roll? And you can still do your gospel songs, but you have to mix it up. We can't just hire you as a straight out gospel group anymore." So that was a hard decision. We kicked that around for several weeks, and we decided, well, maybe we'll do this. Maybe we'll mix it up. We'll do all types of music and mix it up. And maybe we'll get famous. Then we can do whatever we want. You know, like if we get some popularity, then we can have some clout and we can decide what kind of music we want to do. But our brother George, our older brother George, who played the bass, he said, I will not sing rock and roll. I will not do blues. I will not do anything but gospel. Well, we says, come on, man, we need to do this. And after we do this, then we can come back and do our gospel music. Maybe we'll get famous and then we can do what we want. But he said, no, I won't do that. So Joe and Lester and me says, if you don't do this, we're going to kick your... So we kind of forced him to do that. But after he gave us some thought and he think, well, maybe we can do this. We'll get a reputation. We'll get a famous and we'll do what we want. So he went along with it, but he was totally unhappy in the beginning. And he was on stage and he was very angry. But he played, when he was angry, he took it out on his bass.
And that may have been good.
It just made him one of the greatest bass players ever.
There you go,
he
man.
He took his aggressions out on his instrument. But after a while, he really started, he just blended right in and he started to have a lot of fun and enjoying it.
In 1965, I guess it was Barbara Dane that introduced you to Pete Seeger, right?
Yes, indeed.
Okay, and then that around that time, is that when you got invited to go to play the Newport Folk Festival?
Yes, indeed. We went to we got invited to play the Newport Folk Festival. We were just going to do the workshops. We didn't have a main stage presentation. We were just to do workshops. But one of the older blues artists came down sick or something, and he couldn't make it. So they asked us if we would take his place and do his stage set. So we were delighted to do that. All those beautiful people just waiting to hear music, and we were delighted to be able to step in and cover that part for the. I think it was Lance Lipscomb or some one of those old blues guys. Mm-hmm. He got sick. Anyway, it was everything that was happening then was for a very positive reason. There was a good reason behind it all. So we took to that stage. We got on that stage, Mr. Weens had said to us, by the way, you can't do The Time Has Come Today here, because this is a folk event, and The Time Has Come Today is not folk music. Oh, we says, oh, sure. We don't have to do Time Has Come Today. We'll just do some gospel and some blues and you know, stuff like that. Some, you know, and we got on that stage and we looked out there and we saw a valley of people. We looked at each other and we says, are we going to pass up this opportunity? And we did The Time Has Come Today.
Now, I also read, Willie, where the crowd was rushing to the stage, breaking down fences and everything because they were just so into the moment. Was that same event?
Well, you know, like we were on that stage and we were, and you know, 2 or 3 days of Michael Roll, the Boat of Show, and and Down by the Riverside, and when you sit there for a couple of days listening to that, and something totally the opposite comes on, it's going to get you, it's going to get everybody's attention. And we didn't want to miss out on that opportunity. So we bursted out, The Time Has Come Today, man. We disrupted every workshop because like I said, everybody, they had these little bamboo surroundings, you know, that housed the workshops.
Yeah.
Man, everything was flattened to the ground, and the Now it's a full-fledged rock and roll psychedelic concert going on. Everybody rushed to the stage and that just changed everything. And then at the end of our set, Mr. Weems came out and says, "That was not folk music.
That was rock and roll."
Yeah, that was not folk music, and you guys will never, ever play the Newport Folk Festival again. Well, we did it 3 consecutive years, back-to-back by popular demand. The crowd wanted us there, and we did it for three years straight.
All right. That's so fantastic.
We became really good friends with Mr. Weems and everybody, and Pete Seeger and all the beautiful people that was handling that. We were forgiven.
And right after that big show that you guys did, Willie, your album came out, People Get Ready.
Mm-hmm.
You want to talk a little bit about that?
People Get Ready. That was another coincidence that was a positive reason. There was a, like the troubadour here in California, Mr. Wesson, he, for some reason, he did not like the Chambers Brothers, and he had verbally said to some people that we were acquainted with, "I will never hire the effing Chambers Brothers." But he had the hoot nannies there. Certain nights out of the week, there was a hoot nanny. All the folk rooms had a hoot night. And we would go to the troubadour and do the hoot nights. And one night we were there doing the hoot. We were doing gospel. We were doing an upbeat song titled, "I've Got It." Something about religion that I don't understand, but I got it. Whatever it is, I got it. And we came off stage, and this guy with a heavy English accent came and says, "I like you chaps. I like your energy. I have a television show in London. I'm thinking about bringing it to America. And I want you chaps to be a part of that." So and he took our number. We got all excited. We told all our friends, and I think maybe 3 years went by. We never heard one thing from this guy. Okay. And one day our phone rang, and it was, "Hi, this is Jack Good. I have my show in California now. Can you be down at ABC at 4:00 this afternoon? We're going to do the pilot." That was Shindig.
Oh, wow. Cool.
Yeah. So we went and we did the original pilot for Shindig. And later on, we were the background group on that, for that show, like the, you know, artist that came on and needed background. That was Darlene Love, and the Blossoms were the female background singers. And the Chambers Brothers, we were the male background singers.
Cool.
And he wanted Curtis, when People Get Ready came out, Curtis Mayfield and the Impressions, Mr. Jack Good called them and says, "Hey, I want that song in my next segment. Can you guys come and do the show?" Well, Curtis Mayfield didn't understand how national TV works. And he says, "Well, how much do we get paid?" And, "Well, you don't get paid to do national television. You get $1 million worth of the exposure is what you're after. You won't get a check." So Curtis Mayfield replied and says, "If we don't get paid, we don't play." So Mr. Good called us and said, "Hey, I want that song in my next show. Do you chaps know that song? It had just came out." And we said, "Sure, we know it," but we didn't know it. So he says, "I want that. Can you guys come down and do that song? I want it on my next show." So we ran out and got the record, brought it back to our rehearsal studio and tried to learn it by 4:00 in the afternoon. We did not learn it. And we went on national TV and we did that song, but it had such a beautiful, we kind of rearranged it, made it like more spiritual. And You know, Curtis Mayfield, he never spoke to us again.
Really?
He hated our guts for doing that. I guess because we kind of messed up his song. We didn't get it right. We didn't do it right. I don't know what the reason for that was, but he would never speak to us again.
Well, you did a great job with it.
That's how we got that song into. Afterwards, we learned the lyrics and we recorded it. We did a cover on it, and I think we did a pretty good job on that with that song. He should be happy because he wrote the song. We're sending him to the bank now.
That's right. He gets all those royalties every time it's played. You know. It was soon after that that you guys did The Time Has Come Today. Of course, you had done it in 65, but you came out with a new version of it that was went from 2.5 minutes to about 11 minutes.
And the first time we recorded that, it was like a 2.5 minute song that just didn't really make any sense. And like at our band house, I was laying in my bedroom one night. I was laying there and that's when psychedelic music was trying to be. And like, I had never heard any psychedelic music that really made any sense. It sounded like somebody just took a bunch of pots and pans and threw it up in the air, and whatever the sound was, that was considered to be, when it hit the floor, that was considered to be psychedelic. It had no rhythm, it had no beat, it had no pulse, it had no energy. And I was laying there in my bed and I was thinking, time has come today. And I got this idea, like, to make that our contribution to psychedelic music. I got all excited. I jumped up. I ran. And I said, "Hey guys, we got to go down and we got to go in the studio. I got this idea for The Time Has Come Today, and it's going to be a lot longer than it is. We don't know if we can get away with recording it or not. But this is so I got everybody, and we went down in the studio and we started going. All of a sudden, we need a cowbell sound. We need a clock tick." Tick-tock, tick-tock. We need the clock sound. And Lester, you scream. Scream right here. Scream, scream. And Joe, laugh at the same time. Ha, 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 ha. Scream, scream, ha, ha, ha. Make some crazy noise. Just make a lot of noise. We rehearsed it, and we started to enjoy that. But my brother George, he hated it. We started using it in our live performances. And I saw people, I've seen people grab their heads and run out the door. And, you know, because it'd get pretty intense, you know, in the middle of that.
What I really liked about it, Willie, is that you locked in on A.
Yeah.
And you stayed on it. And then and then I'm hearing a kind of a phasing thing going on. You've got drums on one side, you got guitar on the other, which is unusual in itself in a mix.
Yeah.
And then you're doing the vocal thing and getting this psychedelic thing going. I mean, it's got some really great creative work going on in there, man.
To this day, man, every time I sit down and seriously listen to that cut, I hear something that I had never noticed before. I hear it just never stops.
I know.
It just don't stop, you know, like, so my brothers thought I was crazy, but that whole idea just came. I heard it in my head before I introduced it to my brothers. We got to have a clock. We couldn't find a cowbell nowhere or anything to make. We were visiting some friends that lived off of an alleyway, and somebody had dumped a bunch of old car parts in the alley. There was a bumper from the old Plymouth car with the bumper guard thing on it. So we ripped that bumper guard off, and that was the first original clock, tick-tock. And my brother, with a drumstick, made the clock sound with the bumper guard from an old Plymouth car. And the screaming came from a song I heard when I was a kid that scared me to death, called Mr. Death.
Uh-huh.
Mr. Death. It was like a lot of screaming, and like death was taking over people, and people were screaming. So that's where all the screaming, that's where that idea. But I was just laying there in the bed, and all of a sudden I heard this whole thing. I felt it. I saw it happening. I saw the crowd reaction. I saw the whole thing. So I introduced it to my brothers, and they were looking at me like, "What are you talking about? Scream right here, scream there, and stay on the A. Just stay on that A." But when we signed with Columbia Records, man, there was a welcome to the label party. Mr. Davis, Clive Davis was there, and everybody of importance was there. And for about 2 or 3 hours, we carried on there, and there was a food orgy going on. Like, there was food everywhere, and we just celebrated our signing with Columbia Records. And Mr. Davis, after an hour or so, he says, "I gotta leave. I have other appointments." And he said, "Welcome to the label," and all of that. And he walked out the door, and he was walking out the door. He leaned back in the door when he says, "Oh, by the way, that song, 'The Time Has Come Today,' that you guys do," we were excited. Yeah, yeah, yeah. He says, we won't be recording that. We don't do that kind of shit on this label.
Talk about David Rubinson. Talk about David Rubinson and how all that finally ended up.
Yeah. Well, David Rubinson, he was a staff producer at Columbia Records. And he had followed us around to our live performances, and he had seen the reaction to that. And one of his biggest dreams was to someday record The Time Has Come Today as it was done live, as we did it live. 11, you know, sometime it went for 20 minutes or more on stage live. And that was one of his biggest dreams, was to someday record that. And when Clive Davis said that, he literally broke down and was crying crocodile tears, saying, oh my God, he's not going to allow us to record that. Now, David Rubinson had a wife and I think two kids at the time, paying rent. And a couple of days went by and he called us and he says, guys, I have a suggestion. I don't care what he says. We're going to record that song. He says, I'm probably going to lose my job, but we're going to record The Time Has Come Today. When we get our recording date, you guys show up 45 minutes to an hour early. We're going to plug up the amps. We're going to record it live. We can't listen back. We can't overdub. We can't splice. We can't do anything. We can't even listen back. When it's finished, I'll just shut the machines down like we have never been there and nobody will ever know the difference. Well, that's exactly what we did. It was all done in one take. Can you imagine that? At the same time it was being recorded, David Rubinson was doing the effects at the same time it was being recorded. And at, like he said, when we finished, we just shut down everything and waited for our regular appointment time. And then we started all over. The next time Clive Davis heard the song, it was already recorded and on the album, 11 minutes and some seconds. That was totally unheard of in those days. If you had a record that was more than 2.5 minutes long, the DJs they hesitated to play that because it took up too much time. And it was just, we never cared about a number one record. We never was seeking to have a number one, a top record, a top 10. We were comfortable just thinking that we would be somewhere in the top 10 or the top 20. Number one record, your next one has to be a number one record, and your next one, and your next one. The minute you don't have that number one hit, you're on your way out. And we never wanted to be in that position. We wanted something that would sustain, that would last, that had lasting quality. We did. How many hit records were there that we don't even remember today? They were the number one record for 10 weeks, for 10 months. And now today, we don't even remember those number one hit records because they didn't have that lasting quality. And that's what we were seeking the whole time. We were never trying to have a number one record. We just wanted something that was gonna last. And when Clive Davis found out that we had recorded that, he did fire David Rubinson, lost his job. But after a short period of time, that every disc jockey in the world had to play The Time Has Come Today. Even the AM station started doing long cuts because they had to compete with the FM state. The FM stations had freedom, they could do whatever they want. But the AM stations had to be a 2 minute, 2.5 minute song, nothing above that. But after The Time Has Come Today, AM stations had to play long cuts as well, because they would be out of the race if they didn't. And that's when we got Light My Fire, we got In the Garden of Eden, we got all of the Everybody Was Free. Every artist that I've ever known weren't comfortable with trying to put together a 2.5 minute package that's gonna really tell the story. You know, that's really not enough time to really tell a story. You know, but a lot of number one records, it was not so much pertaining to the lyric content. It was the beat. It was something about the beat, the breaks, the something in the song that made it popular. But it had no lasting value. My Soul Has Been Psychedelicized was a word that it was never a word before. And my brother Joe, the time has come today, it all happened like this. I was sitting downstairs in our band house. I was just playing, that riff came to me. And I was sitting downstairs, down at the dining room table with an acoustic guitar, playing that riff. And my brother Joe was upstairs in his room writing the lyrics to The Time Has Come Today. Well, he came to the top of the stairs and he says, "What's that you're playing down there?" I says, "I don't know. It just came to me. It's just coming to me. I don't know. I don't have a title. I don't know what it is, but I like it." And he says, I was upstairs in my room writing and I heard that music and it fits very well with the lyrics that I'm writing." I said, "Well, what you got?" So him and me, we went down in the studio and sure enough, it was a marriage. The music that was coming to me and the lyrics that he was writing was like meant for each other. And he got to that part, he's, "I've been loved and put aside. I've been crushed by tumbling tides and my soul has..." He couldn't come up with a lyric. I says, "My soul has been psychedelicized." And he looked at me and he says, "We can't say that." I said, what else are you going to say? He says, "We can't say that. What about the church? What about the church people?" And I said, I can't think of anything else, but my soul has been psychedelicized. He says, "I won't say that." I said, "Joe, what are you going to say, man?" He says, "I'll come up with some lyrics for that." So a couple of weeks went by and I said, "Joe, did you come up with some lyrics for that part?" He says, "No, I can't come up with anything." I said, "Joe, you got to say my soul has been psychedelicized." He says, "Willie, how are we going to say something like that? You were considering the church and religion and all of that. And when you start talking about your soul, that's a precious thing." And I said to him, "Joe, you're not saying that for yourself. You're saying it for millions of other people." And he says, "Oh, I hadn't thought about it like that." I says, "That's what we're going to have to use. My soul has been..." That was my contribution to the lyrics. "My soul has been psychedelicized." But he didn't want to do it. But he says, okay, I guess we'll do that. So we're doing it for others. We're not saying that for ourselves. We're saying that for others. So we did it. But, you know, and when it went gold, we were Playboy After Dark, doing that Playboy After Dark show, Hugh Hefner. We're sitting in the green room. James Brown was there. Clive Davis walks in with a big grin on his face. And he says, "Well, fellas, look like we got one." Now it's gold. It's gone gold already. Now he shows up. He's the guy that says he called it a piece of S-H-I-T. Now here he comes and says, we didn't quite know how to handle that. So we was like looking at him with blank faces, like, what do you mean we got one? You condemned the song. And like, to this day, to be honest with you, to this day, I have no idea. I can't figure out why Columbia Records, why did they sign the Chambers Brothers? They weren't a gospel label. They were country and Western label mostly. Why did the Columbia Records sign the Chambers Brothers? The closest thing that Columbia Records had at that time to rock and roll was Paul Revere and the Raiders.
Mm-hmm.
Why did Columbia Records sign the Chambers Brothers? But you know, we had been invited to every major label that you can think of right now, Capitol, Warner, you name it, even Motown. But you know, they offered us a contract. Every single label had the same contract. It was $550 a week, car and wardrobe per man. $550 a week, car and wardrobe. We refused to sign that. We were invited to, that's the first offer that Columbia Records, that was the contract they presented to us, was $550 a week per man, car and wardrobe. We refused to sign it. The last one was Capitol Records. I remember that. We walked in there and there was some little short guy sitting at his desk with his feet up with a burnt down cigar hanging in his mouth that weren't lighted. It was just hanging there. And he barely looked at us. He glanced at us and said, the contract's over there, sign them. Went over, picked up the contract. $550 a week, car and wardrobe. And I said to him, why are you offering us a contract like this? And he get angry, kind of angry. He says, sign the contract. I ain't got all day. Sign the contract. And I said to him, I says, how about royalties and residuals and mechanicals and all of that? And he raised up in his seat and he says, what do you know about that? I says, enough that we are not signing this, SH. We're not signing. We don't give a F if we never make a record. We ain't signing this kind of agreement. He said, sign the damn contract. That's what all the black artists are signing. And I said, well, I was kind of in charge of our group at the time. And I says, we are not signing this. We don't care if we never make a record. We ain't signing this. You know, we're doing okay without a record. We're traveling all from the East Coast to the West Coast, to West Coast to the East Coast, back and forth. We're doing okay without a record. We never had representation. We never had management. We never had any of that great stuff. So a few weeks later, Columbia Records called us again and asked us to come back in and talk signing again. So we went in and they says, just what do you guys want? So I said, we want what everybody else gets, front your upfront money. We want that. And we want whatever we don't want no $550 a week, a car. Why are you going to, we're going to sign an agreement like that. You're going to have some tailor make us some shiny suits. You're going to go down to a used car lot and buy us a red Cadillac. And that's, that's 2 or 3 years old. And we don't need nothing like that. So we're not signing anything. That was just, what do you want? Hey, we want some nice front money, like you give all the other artists. you know, why is it going to be different because we're of color? Why are you offering us $550 a week? You're not offering that to other artists. We will never sign that. Well, what do you want? So we gave them a figure. And right here where I'm sitting right now, I'm sitting in the house that me and my brothers bought and gave our parents. When we were working in the cotton fields back in Mississippi, I remember as young as being 5, 6, or 7 years old, we always promised our mom and dad, someday we're going to buy you guys a house. Someday we're going to buy you guys a house. And they would laugh and say, yeah, that'll be the day. So when we signed with Columbia Records, they gave us a nice piece of money up front. We got right on the phone. We called our parents and says, remember that house we always promised you guys? They says, yeah, but go find that house wherever you want it. We're ready to buy that house we promised you forever. So a couple of weeks went by. We didn't hear anything from our parents. So we called and says, did you find a house? And my mom says, were you guys serious about that? We says, yeah, we were serious about that. She says, well, we just thought you guys were saying it like you always have said. You've said that your whole life. And we just thought you're just doing it, still doing that. No, go find the house. So they found this house. We came out and we liked the neighborhood. We liked the house. It's a 3-bedroom house, 2 baths, 2-car garage and a nice patio in the back. And there's a lot of grandkids. We says, yes. Yes. So we bought this house for our parents and gave it to our parents. And when we came off the road, I came and lived. We all came right back to this house, slept on the floor, on the couch, just whatever. And then everybody got their own places. And it was just my mom and dad. It's a three-bedroom house. So whenever all the other guys got apartments, I said, well, maybe I'll just stay here with my parents. I can drive them to the market or to church or whatever. So I just stayed here with them. So I stayed right here with them the whole time. And when they were old and passing away, they always said, whatever you do, keep this house, keep the house. You never know. Somebody might need a place to stay, a place to sleep. Just keep the house for that purpose. But when my parents passed away, my brothers and sisters, they didn't quite understand what it meant to honor their wishes, because they had their own homes and everything like that. So, but I was still living here, and I told them, I said, Mom and Dad always said for us to keep the house. So everybody else wanted to sell the house. So I bought everybody off and kept the house. So I kept the house for that reason. So there's about 5 people get their mail here right today, and there's been about 5 or 6 people that has came and lived here till they got better. And the reason to keep the house was that was the whole purpose. My parents wanted this house to be kept. It says somebody might need a place to sleep, you know. So that's where I am right now. I'm sitting here in the house, and I'm quite proud of myself for doing that.
Good for you, Willie. Good for you, man. Great story. I got to tell you, of course, in 1968, your big hit song was number 11 for 5 consecutive weeks on the Billboard Hot 100. And I know you did a lot of other things too. You were on the Mike Douglas show. You were on the Ed Sullivan show. You did a lot of TV things.
Johnny Carson.
You did, some Levi commercials.
Yeah.
Levi's
chords.
Yeah. And you did, on Maria Muldaur's album, you did Gospel Nights album that she did. You sang with her on that. By the way, she appeared in El Paso a couple, 2 or 3 years ago at a friend of mine's studio. I used to manage a band, and they've got a studio here, and she came and did a concert there. But I think right now would be a good time for me to share with you something that happened yesterday that I totally unexpected. A good friend of mine by the name of Johnny Thompson, he was a drummer also, just like myself, and we grew up together in the same neighborhood. We were like 2 or 3 blocks apart from where we lived in the Lower Valley here in El Paso. Anyway, he was a local DJ here in El Paso, okay? And yesterday, I saw on Facebook that he was celebrating his 77th birthday yesterday. And there was a picture that his sister had posted of them being at a Mexican food restaurant in Florida where he lives and all that. So I reached out to Johnny and, you know, called him and said, you know, I couldn't get him. And so he called me back. And I said, man, happy 77th. He said, oh, thanks, man, and all that. So I said, yeah, tomorrow I'm going to be doing an interview on my show with good old Willie Chambers, you know, the Chambers brothers. He said, oh, man, he said, those guys, he said, I was one of the first DJs to play a lot of their music, you know. And so anyway, we got to talking more about it and everything. And then he says, I have something that I'm going to try to find, and I'll send it to you if I find it. Well, Willie, it was about an hour or two later, I got this document right here, okay? And I'm going to read it to you real quick, okay?
All righty.
It's dated February 10th, 1971. Dear Johnny, just a little note to express our thanks for the great radio interview you set up for the Chambers Brothers. I would also like to say thank you again for the fabulous airplay you are giving to our new album. Without cooperative people like you, rock music would be nowhere today.
Amen.
Sincerely, Joe Chambers. This letter right here. That's
his signature.
That's his signature.
Doolot.
And that's Doolot. I guess that's the letterhead of your company that you all signed with.
That's right. My brother Joe, I, George Lester and me, Joe is our youngest brother, and he was rambunctious. And we decided we better give this guy something to do. He needs something to keep him occupied. So we made him our band leader. And that's why that his signature is on that letter, on that note, because he was now our band at that time. He was our band leader. And still to this day, that's his position.
Fantastic, man. Well, I had to share this with you because I thought this came around full circle, and then we got to talking about the song Funky that you guys did, and I'm gonna play that right now. Johnny and I both love that song so much. It's a drummer's dream song to play. I love to play funk anyway. And
funky, you know, I'm talking funky. Lester, I think Lester wrote that.
Oh, did he? Okay.
Yeah.
O'Brien Keenan he kicks butt on this song. He's right in the pocket. He's really doing some fun stuff. And so, in fact, I was listening to it last night when Johnny was talking to me about the letter that he sent. He said, "Did you have a chance to listen to Funky yet?" And I said, "Oh yeah, man. I hadn't listened to it yet, but I went ahead about 5 minutes later and pulled it up and was listening to it. And I'm in my studio here, really grooving with it, man. Just it's a great song. You guys,
it has that R&B funk.
Oh yeah, man. It's really good stuff. Now you guys had in the can for a long time the Oh My God album. It didn't come out until I think last year it became available on digital formats. And so there are several songs on there that I just want to touch on. I'm going to play just a little bit of the ones that I'm going to talk to you about. But one of them I really like was A Celebration of Life. You want to talk about that song a little bit, and who was it that wrote it, and what was the inspiration?
The inspiration was Newport Folk Festival, that when we first got invited there, all those beautiful people, like life is a celebration. It's to be celebrated. People are not rejoicing and celebrating enough. And that was one of the real reasons for Celebration of Life. Life is a celebration.
Celebration of life. Life is a celebration, all in one and one in all. Listen now and heed the call. Celebrate God the Father. God the Son, celebrate His holy kingdom. God is the Father of us all. Everybody sing the song.
It's for everybody. It's for everybody. And like, we always felt like our freedom is obtained by us as our own. Nobody can give you your freedom. No, there ain't a person nowhere on this planet that can give you your freedom. That's what I get so disgusted with, all the people that's supposed to be black leaders said, give us, let us. You can't be like that. You got to just celebrate. And A Celebration of Life was one of the real reasons for that. My brother Joe predominantly wrote most of the lyrics for that.
It's a great song. Another one that I really like on that album is Mean Old World. Talk about that a little bit.
That's another thing that puzzled me about Columbia Records. They sent us to Philadelphia to be with Gammel and Huff. I don't know if you're familiar with those two. Gammel and Huff was two music producers in Philadelphia. They sent us to Gamble and Huff. For what reason, I don't know, but that was some material from that, from the Gamble and Huff thing. When we went there, and I think a guy named Bonnie Siegel might have been his name that wrote that song.
I've heard that name.
Yeah.
What to expect?
Who said this world is good?
Who said
this world is good?
Who said
this world is good?
Who said
this world is good?
Who said
mean old world?
So I don't know where his lyric content came from, what was going on in his mind or in his head, but that was some of the mean old world and this little piece of land and all of that whole session never got what we consider to be properly handled or released. It was, I don't know what the purpose for that was to this day. Like I said, I don't know why Columbia Records signed the Chambers Brothers. I think we were supposed to be a tax write-off at the end of the year.
Willie, talk about From the Hair of My Chinny Chin Chin.
That was from that same session with Gamble and Huff in Philadelphia. That was, I think Columbia Records was maybe trying to establish an identity for the Chambers Brothers. Were we going to be R&B? What were we going to be? What was going to be our title? It must have been kind of complicated for the label, because what is the category for the Chambers Brothers? What is the category? And like, I think the hair on my chin and chin was maybe trying to establish the fact that we could be R&B.
Yeah. And in fact, that's what I'm picking up through all of these songs, you know, Any Old Time as well. I'm kind of thinking along the same, around the same thing that you're talking about, is that they were probably trying to ID you guys, trying to put you in a new category or whatever. But anyway, but those are really, really good songs. I really like everything on that album. It's all really great.
We liked it too. We often wondered why it never got properly released.
Yeah.
What was the purpose?
The other day when you and I were having a phone conversation, we were kind of comparing war stories a little bit about being on the road and, you know, and preparing yourself and the ups and downs of, you know, getting yourself, you know, good to go to be on the road and everything. And then talking about the rewards of being on the road. You want to talk about that a little bit?
All the rewards was like, the rewards made it all. The rewards made it all, like that note you just read a while ago. And these are the kind of things that made it. These are the rewards that you're seeking. You know, like all the ups and downs is like, it's just like when we sang in the fields doing all that hard farm work. We would get singing and you didn't notice how hard the work was or how long the day might be. It's music. It's very rewarding, and it's an honor and a blessing to be able to present music to people. Music, everybody don't have that ability to represent or to perform music, and like there's hard times and there's great times, but all of the rewards overweigh any bad situation that you could ever have. The travel, like I remember sometime we had as many as 2 to 3 flights in one day from one city to another city, and like. But to tell you the truth, I would never want to travel like that. It's just after so many flights, you feel like you're out of the safety zone. And you every time you fly, you feel like this could be your last flight. And when it gets to that point, it really gets to wear on your nerve a little bit, because you're 35,000 feet in the air, and you know that's a long way to jump.
Especially with polar bears down below you.
Oh yeah, we in Alaska, we did crash. We, you know how the plane come down twirling in the movies? That's how we came down out of. There were some promoters in Haines, Alaska, in the glaciers. Everything they did, tons of people showed up for. And one day they were laughing and joking about it. And they says, what if we put on a festival in the dead of the hardest part of winter and see if people would come to that? And that's what they did. They did that, and they invited the Chambers brothers to come. It was outdoors, and they put metal chairs for people to sit in. It was like, let's see if the people will come, man. But there's only two ways into that area where we were in the glaciers, like some hundred thousands of years ago, it cracked open. It's like, you were like mountains, it's ice, it's mountains of ice, big blue mountains, big ice, and it broke apart. And like there's a runoff down, and there's a barge that's four to five hours on a barge. You can get in there, and then they can fly small planes, small aircraft can fly in that channel. You can't get a big commercial plane in there because there's just not enough room. So we chose to fly in there instead of 5 hours on a barge. And when it was all over, we had to get out of there because we had to get back to our gigs. And so they chartered these 9-passenger planes to get people out of there, man. It was thousands and thousands of people there, and everybody now wants to get out of there. And like, it was so cold there. When my brother Lester put his harmonica to his lips, it stuck.
No.
It froze, you know, like, had to get some warm water to get the harmonica off his lip.
Wow.
And it was just so miserable. It was almost impossible to play. But when we were leaving there, we told the promoters, if you decide to do this again, don't invite us. But anyway, we get the first plane out. It's a 9-passenger plane. We had 9 people, but we had amps, guitars. And there was when we travel like that, the most roadies we ever took was maybe 2 roadies. We had 3 or 4 or 5 roadies, but we didn't take our whole crew when we went on trips like that. So I think we had maybe took a couple of roadies. And it's like that. So that's 7 of us, exactly. 2 roadies and the band, Brian Brothers, and 2 girls. There was room for 2 more people, so it makes a total of 9 people. But they had luggage also. Now, actually, the plane was overloaded. So we get flying out of there, we're buzzing along, and on the left engine, an oil bubble appeared on the side of the engine. And then it started to grow, and it got bigger, and it got bigger, and then it streaked off. But then another oil bubble starts to appear, and it streaked off, and it started to intensify. Then now there was a whole collection of oil running out of that left engine. And everybody, the girl passengers, they were the first to notice that. And they said, hey, the oil is coming out of that engine. And that got everybody's attention. So we are like watching that. And pretty soon there was a stream of oil. It dumped, all the oil came out. It just a stream of oil. And then the engine started to smoke. And the pilot says, we're probably going to lose that engine, but we should be able to continue on the one engine. That's okay if you got 9 people, maybe, but not with equipment, amps, and amps weigh a ton. If you got 4 or 5 amps, that plane is overloaded, number one, to begin with. When that engine went, the pilot says, we should be able to continue on that one engine. But when it finally went, it smoked, and then it started cluck, 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 and then it went cluck. The propeller was sticking straight up. When that, the minute that engine shut down, the other one went from too much stress. And the pilot, he starts looking from left to right like this. There's a wall of ice to your right, left, a wall of ice to your right. There's nothing but ice. You're surrounded by mountains of ice. Down below is the runoff. And nobody has been able to withstand that water. Nobody has survived that water more than 4 minutes. And we got young musicians on there. They're freaking out and screaming, and we're trying to calm them down. Our guitar player, he's just freaking out. He snatches his hat off and he's praying to God, "Oh God, please don't let me die. Don't let me die. I won't cheat on my wife anymore. Please. I promise I won't cheat on my wife no more." And all this kind of stuff. And one of our nephews was playing in the band, and he's freaking out too. And him and I were sitting near each other. So he's freaking out. And I'm saying, "Man, hey, what can you do, man? You know, don't, if we're going to perish, don't do it in peace. Do it, relax. I can't do it. I can't relax. So I started to take my boots off. And he looked at me and he says, "Why are you taking your boots off?" I says, "Well, if we fall in the water, I got 4 minutes to survive in the water. If I got 4 minutes, I want my 4 minutes. I don't want boots full of water taking me down." So that kind of took his mind off of what was actually happening. And he says, "You know, the drummer can't swim." I says, "I know." And I said, I'm not that good a swimmer myself. I can swim, but I ain't no distance swimmer. And then a guitar player, he can't swim either. He can swim, but my nephew says, "When we hit the water, I'll take care of the drummer and you take care of him." So that was that's what we were planning, to save them for 4 minutes when we hit the water, because they can't swim. But then all of a sudden we broke out of the glacier, and now I see trees below. I see trees below, and the plane is like, and then all of a sudden it did something. I don't know. Everything went crazy. All of a sudden, you didn't know up from down. The plane was twirling and coming down. First thing, the nose go up. It looked like you're flying into heaven, but that's how they come down. The nose go up and then they come down kind of like that. And it looked like we're climbing, but we're coming down. And then I look out the window again, and we're getting close to treetops. I can see trees go, it's like going past you like that. And I saw, when we were near the ground, I saw a flagpole. I saw an antenna, tall antenna, in the when it was going by, slow motion, like trees going by, like rotating in front of you. And like I saw an antenna with a flag on it, with some kind of a red flag on it. And the pilot says, "If you survive this, don't jump off the plane. Don't jump off the plane. There's polar bears down there and they'll tear you apart. If you survive this, just stay on the plane. Stay on the plane till somebody come and rescue us." And like, now I'm sitting there like, if the plane don't kill me, the bears will. If the crash don't kill us, the bears will. But by the time it just so happened, God is amazing. I say this, and I will always say this: God is the answer. Man, there's no other way. There were some men working down on the ground, and some guy owned a lot of properties there, and he wanted to sell off some of the land. And they were there building a runway for small aircraft to land so that they could survey the properties. And they had dozed like a mile strip of soil, just dozed it up to like ceiling high. And that's what we fell into.
Wow.
Nobody got a scratch.
And were you still coming down, tail down?
Down.
Oh, wow.
That. And that's when the antenna with the flag on it, I saw when it was passing, slow motion passing by, you know, like the men saw us coming down that was working there, and they had some kind of doom buggy or something. And they were there when we hit by the time we hit the ground, they were there with coffee, donuts, and blankets.
Wow.
And nope, not one person got not even a bump on the head. It's just amazing. And we landed right into that soil that had been dozed up to build a runway. And that's what we fell into.
Man, what a story, Willie. Man, I had no idea.
That was amazing. But then we got to sit there and wait. They're going to send two planes to get us out of there now. We're sitting there waiting, and it's showing up two planes. There's no runway. There's nothing that, like, it's just rough terrain. Like, two non-passenger planes came to take us out of there because they realize now they can't fly overloaded like that. So they sent two planes to get us out of there. That's fine and dandy, but now you just crashed in one plane. You got to get on another plane and take to the air again, you know, like, and you said, oh, God, please. You just feel like you have flown out of your safety zone. You're too many times in the air like that. And you fly out of the zone of safety or something. Anyway, the two planes came. Now they got to figure out how they're going to land, and they finally get the planes on the ground. And I heard the pilots talking among themselves, saying, "Do you think we got enough space to get into the air? What about those trees over there?" And the other pilot says, "Well, we just got to hope that we can get up off the ground before we get to those trees." And wow. And like, I heard that, but I didn't say anything to my brothers or anybody. I overheard that conversation. So that's how when we got on those planes, it just, man, it was boom, 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 because it's rough. Boom, 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 boom. And they're gunning, trying to get enough speed to leave the ground. And man, it's just a few feet. We must have cleared those treetops at maybe a little more than 10 feet. That's how severe it was. They didn't have enough running space to really make a clear exit from the earth to upper atmosphere. But by the grace of God, we managed to get off the ground. But we just barely cleared those treetops to get into the air again.
Well, man, I guess you, God made you a pilot, man. You got a cool pilot hat on.
That's why I'm the pilot now. I control all my life.
What a story. What a story, Willie. Well, you know, another thing. We're going to wrap this up pretty quick now, but I wanted to tell you that, you know, another thing that we experienced about being on the road and was a major reward is the friends that you make.
Oh, the beautiful people, the beauty, all that makes it all worthwhile. Like the note you read a while ago and the beautiful people remembering you, things that happen, like when you call your friend and he called you back and you told him you were going to interview one of the Chambers brothers. He said, oh, I played their record. That's the rewards. That, and you meet all these beautiful people. That was in the 60s. I still have good friends that we met in the 60s. We still call each other. We call each other Christmas and wishing everybody happy birthday. And occasionally we run into each other. It's just so, you've been there. You know what that feeling is like that to meet the, it's the people, all the beautiful people you meet that just kind of erases all the pain and agony that you, that the people come to see you perform. They don't realize what you really go through. It ain't always good accommodation. It ain't always a pleasant trip. Sometimes it's you're missing a flight. Sometimes you can't get a flight and you're going through all of that. But when you get on that stage, you can't present that. You can't be sure that on your face. You can't, you gotta cheer the people up. And it's a challenge, but by the grace of God, we are able to get up there and make somebody happy and make them forget their miseries and take them to another place and psychedelize their moment.
Willie, I gotta tell you today, you have put me in that place today, man. This experience of visiting with you, and it's been an honor and a true pleasure. You know, I'm proud now to say that I've made me another new friend, you know.
yeah.
You know, it's coming from a drummer that grew up playing drums with psychedelic music and psychedelic rock. And yes. Today I feel like my soul has definitely been psychedelicized, man.
Well, see, this is all part of the rewards, man. This is it don't stop.
It don't stop, man.
It's still going on.
And any time you ever want to call me, I'm your friend to talk to, man. I love visiting with you today, and I love your stories. I love your inspiration. I love your messages. I love your music. You're a true brother, man. Thank you so much for being a part of my show.
Thank you for having me a part of your show. Like you reminded me, you nudged my memory, and things that probably was laying dormant in the back of my mind somewhere. But then you bring up things, you mention things like the music, funky, and let's get funky, and the time has come today. How did that happen? And all that is great stuff, man. We all need that. And thank you. Made my day.
Thank you, Willie. God bless you, my friend. And let's do stay in touch, okay?
Yes, indeed. We will. We the time, shall. We will.
The time has come today. For sure, my brother. Thank you, man.
Yes. All right, baby. Thank you, man. Thank
all right. You. You be safe and take care of yourself, and let's stay in touch.
Likewise. Yes,
all
indeed.
Right.
Yes,
take care, indeed. Buddy. Bye-bye.
All right. Love you, man.
Love you too, man. Take care, all right?
All right.
Be safe.
Yeah, you too, man.